Here it is. I had a lot of requests about gear and a lot of requests about Fender Jazz Basses. So I guess I'll call this one Fender Jazz Bass the Movie. And I'll attempt to puke up everything I know about a jazz bass. Okay. Stay tuned, stand by, hold on. Okay, so this is my 1975 Fender Jazz Bass. First jazz bass was 1960. Didn't have controls like this, it had a stacked tone and volume. Leo was really proud of this guitar, this bass guitar. He incorporated a lot of cool stuff into, you know, all the cutaways, so it just felt right up against you. People ask me, what are the covers for? This one, the sponge is falling out of it. There used to be a sponge mute that lived in there that goes across the strings. Yeah, there's a picture of the ashtray with the piece of sponge across that fell off of mine. But you still see the remnant on mine. And also more stack knob stuff. That's what this one is for. And also, way back in 1960, the wiring on everything was pretty much crap. So these were an attempt to offer some sort of shielding to the poor unsuspecting guy that was getting aircraft radio on his jazz bass. Okay, what else? Yeah, this one's got all the goodies. It's got the bullet truss rod adjustment up top here. Hold on, we'll flip it over. Also, we got some different versions of that muting system early on, where it was actually detached from the cover, and also that brass strip used as a ground that was a used early on before they drilled the hole through the guitar and come up under the bridge with a wire. So if you see that little piece of brass strip, that's the traditional grounding strap for the bridge. Oh, and here you can see they were using the threaded rod so you could vary the string spacing. You can still get those bridges as well. So this has also got the three bolt tilt neck. So in case you don't understand how this works, these two are screws. That's an actual bolt that threads into a plate that's mounted on the back side of the neck, and in that little hole there's a set screw on an opposing plate that allows you to adjust the tilt function at the heel of the neck, which you see, because they got rid of all this cool stuff. Like, they got rid of this because it costs money. And they went to what I'll show you in the next one. Same thing with the bullet truss rod, gone. Also, the you know, the three bolt adjustable neck went away for the four bolt. And yeah, just to be a little bit more crazy, look at the G&L. G&L went to a six bolt with custom fit neck to body fabrication. Just so you know, each neck is fitted to each guitar as a final process of assembly. So the final neck pocket isn't cut till they decide which neck they're putting on the guitar, and it's an unbelievably tight fit in that pocket. So, like, from an end user standpoint, you know, this is like the best adjustment you could ask for. It doesn't get stripped. It's easy to get the wrench in. You can't make a mistake about what size wrench you're sticking down in that hole. You know, so my vote is bullet all the way. Okay, on to the later developments. Oh yeah, I wanted to add, like, all the binding and stuff on this. This is 1975. This was the CBS guys that decided the guitars needed this. They didn't think they were fancy enough. So whenever you see a Fender guitar with a bound neck. That is totally nothing to do with Leo Fender whatsoever. He was totally gone by then. And that's what I know about that. Okay, next. So this is my nephew's jazz bass. This is a Mexican, made in Mexico, about 2002, I think, or something like that. No, 2000, Z0. So nothing really changed, except they ditched the covers. This really isn't any better than the original early Fenders. It's a, a bent piece of metal with holes drilled into it. The newer Fender basses, this is actually a forged piece of metal, or maybe it's an extrusion, but it's a lot beefier and heavier than this. But the same idea. The fail with these is the set screws. They tend to loosen on their own, and also they tend to get gummed up. But here you can see at least they've gone with the same type of material. When you see a plated set screw that's in something that's not plated, or you know, they always get stuck against each other. It never comes apart. Dimensionally, nothing changed. Same tone configuration, two volumes and a tone. Same number of frets. So I think the electronics in the newer ones might be somewhat improved. I know they went to noiseless pickups for a while. Single coil jazz bass can hum a lot. This is true. Okay. But like I said, this was one of Leo's favorite inventions, and it was such a favorite invention that his last invention was just a new version of this. So we'll look at that, and hang on. There's a shot of a few honeys. This is this would be a 1960 or 61 with the stack knobs, and then like I said, they went from that to three knobs very close after that. Oh, there's some other cool picks in here. Ah, somebody wanted to hear a good story. So this one's got a good story, okay? This is a good story. The reason I got this bass guitar is because the very first bass guitar I ever played when I was about 12 years old was a bass just like this. And I said to myself, someday I'm going to have a bass like that. And the way I got to play a bass like this is my friend at school, who was the drummer, he said, you know, his older brother played bass. And he said, you know, we can jam on Saturday at my house. You can come over and play my brother's bass. And, you know, and I never looked back. So that's pretty gracious when you think of that. That somebody lent me a beautiful Fender jazz bass to figure out that that's the thing I wanted to play the most. Pretty crazy, huh? And it's a good time to say hats off and cheers to any parents that let their kids play their guitars and their drums and all that shit, because I'm sure we must have driven you right out of your minds. In fact, I know it. But anyway, back to the jazz bass. It was Leo's favorite invention, and he kept refining it right to the very end when he finished at G&L. This was his last guitar that the guy worked on before he passed away. So once again, still trying improvement. Definitely conquered the bridge aspect of it. Powerful pickups, same sort of control setup. We got an extra fret, so now we got an E up here, as well as here and there. So I got rid of all the pick guard, and I guess I was going to say that about these. If you're into plucking and slapping, there's not a lot of room under here. And that's why when you see Jaco Pastorius there with his bass guitar, geez, I slid into a French accent. Jaco Pastorius! He's got his ripped off so he can get his fingers underneath and creates more space for that sort of technique. But you know, the thing was, when Leo invented that playing style didn't exist. So he rolled with it, Excellent improvements on the bridge and tailpiece. And I gotta say this in all honesty, folks, if you were thinking about buying a Fender, like a new Fender American Standard Jazz Bass, I would say go try a G&L first. That's all I can recommend, because you're getting the same DNA with a lot of improvements. The new American Jazz Bass seem to be a little lighter than my old 75. My 1975 weighs as much as that. This is another Mexican that I had for just knocking around with. Anyhow, there you go. The Jazz Bass, the movie. Just so you know, this is like my second favorite bass guitar out of all the big pile of bullshit I own. And she's got the big old flats on it. Oh yeah, just so you know too, flat wound strings put the most tension on the neck, so make sure you got a good piece of equipment if you're using flats. And the reason they put the most tension on the neck is because they have the most surface area. There you go, Dave's math lesson. Anyway, cheers folks. Thanks for watching the video. The Jazz Bass, the movie. See you soon.